Hello friends, welcome to our channel Knowledge Amplifier. So in my this particular video, I am going to discuss the mean shift clustering algorithm. Okay, so already I have discussed the fundamental intuition of mean shift process, that is how gradually from a lesser dense region we are moving towards higher dense region, right? Now I am going to discuss how we can use that particular concept for clustering. Along with that, we are going to implement the same algorithm in MATLAB also. Okay, so how it works, basically how clustering forms, let me discuss first. Consider these data points in two dimensional feature space. Okay, so you can consider this as maybe annual income and this one as pending score. Okay, and based on which we are trying to cluster our customers, that is small customer segmentation use case, which one I have already discussed in detail while discussing k-means algorithm, right? Now you can easily understand from the visual inspection that this is going to be form one cluster and this is going to form another cluster. That is, two clusters are present in our data, which is quite clear. Now, how using mean shift we can conclude that two clusters are present? Very simple. Just recall the visualization which I have discussed, and that's what the importance of visualization. I have shown you clearly in my previous video visualization that suppose you consider this particular cluster. So we can, if we start from this data point as initial starting point, then it will converge to this particular center. If we start from this data point, then also it will converge to this center. Starting from this data point, it will converge to this center. Okay, that is, if the data points are belonging to one particular cluster, then all the data points after successive iteration will be reaching to same center. Okay, or their finishing point will be same. Okay, right? Similarly, if you consider this particular set of points, wherever you start, either that may be this data point or maybe this data point or maybe this data point, any data point present in this region will finish their journey somewhat here, because here the density is maximum. And using this, we can form the cluster. Okay, that is, for each data point, we'll be applying our mean shift process. And if some data points are finishing to a same location, that means they are belonging to same cluster. Like here, all the data points will finish their journey somewhere at the middle of this particular, somewhere here. So we'll be concluding all these data points are belonging to that, this one single cluster. Then all these data points, okay, as they are close to each other, so individually if we run mean shift for individual data points, they will finish their journey somewhere here. Okay, so as their finishing point for all the data points are same, so we'll be concluding that all the data points are belonging to another particular cluster. Okay, so this is how we are doing the grouping. Okay, so the thing is that I hope you have understood how mean shift concept can be used for clustering. And the best part is, like in k-means, we have to specify what is the k value, how many cluster has to be formed. Here in mean shift, we no need to do like that. Here, number of how many clusters are going to form? Very simple, from the intuitive discussion itself, we can say the number of clusters will be equal to number of dense region. Like here, two dense region present, so two clusters going to form, which is quite obvious. Okay, right? But there is a very important parameter which we need to set very accurately while implementing this mean shift algorithm. And if we just put the proper value for that particular parameter, then only we'll be getting proper clustering. Otherwise we'll be getting some noisy result. Okay, and that is what, that is nothing but the radius to be considered while computing mean shift algorithm, right? You recall we considered a radius within which all the data points we have considered, which are coming under that particular circular area, right? So the radius is a very important parameter. And if you take very small radius, there is problem. And if you take very big radius, then also there will be problem. Let us try to understand. So suppose consider very small radius. Okay, that is, suppose these two data points in this region, suppose we are starting our mean shift algorithm. So suppose this point is our starting point, point of interest. Now we have chosen very small radius, right? So we are starting from this point, we have not created any cluster. Now we have considered a very small amount of radius. So as a result, within that particular circle only these two data points coming, and as a result their center will be present somewhat here, right? Let me just draw it here. So if you consider this particular circular area, for these two if you compute mean, the center point will be coming somewhat here. Now what we'll be doing, we'll be shifting our point of interest from here to here. But then also if you compute a circle which is having the same radius as earlier, then also see only these two data points coming. So as a result, what will happen, that convergence will occur and these two data points will form one single cluster, and this is the problem of mean shift algorithm. Okay, I hope you have understood. So if you take very small radius, then there is a probability that many small clusters will be formed. Like here it might happen that maybe these two data points are forming another cluster, these two data points are forming another cluster. That means if you take small radius, then many clusters will be formed, and each cluster will be small cluster, that is number of data points for each cluster will be small. But rather if you take very big radius, you can understand intuitively, then what will happen, number of clusters going to be formed will be reduced. Okay, so remember this: small radius, more cluster, and big radius, less cluster. Okay, so small radius, more clusters, big radius, lesser number of clusters. Okay, reverse relationship. I hope you have understood this. Now let's go to implementation. The implementation again very simple. Let me discuss CLC clearer closer warning of, as you generally write. I am reading mall customer segmentation data, and I am taking, let me just show you the data once. So here I am running, and let me run right here X. So here you can see that actually there are this customer ID, gender, age, annual income, spending score, all these things are present, right? And this is out of 100, what is the spending score? And as we have discussed that based on annual income and spending score, we are going to use clustering. Okay, so we are taking only fourth and fifth column and all the rows, and we are converting from table to array as we have done earlier in k-means also. Now let's run this particular piece of code and let's check our data. So if you check now X, so this is only having annual income and spending score. Now for mean shift clustering implementation, there is no inbuilt packages present. Rather, we have to use one particular code provided by one MATLAB user. Okay, right? So I am discussing what you need to keep in mind while writing this, using this particular piece of function. Okay, first of all, you need to take function in the same working directory, right? And then this is the function name, mean shift cluster. Point to be noted, here one trick is there. Try to understand the input parameters I am explaining one by one. First one is my data points. But generally what we do in our machine learning, we pass the data such that each row is single data point and columns are features. But here actually reverse thing, okay? That is, rows are basically features, columns are our data points. Like that you can understand. Okay, that is the reverse thing what we generally do in machine learning. That is, in machine learning, rows are data points, columns are features. Here reverse thing. So we have to just take transpose. Okay, remember the first thing, for data you have to take transpose. Then next thing, you have to specify that what is the radius you should consider for applying your mean shift clustering. And then this one is 0 or 1. 0 if you don't want to visualize the result, 1 if you want to visualize the result. I am using 0 because I am going to show you the visualization code separately. I'll be writing by myself. Now here there is no particular way to set this particular radius. You have to go with trial and error method. So first let's check the data once. So scatter of X of colon comma 1 comma X of colon comma 2. Let us check the data. Okay, here I can pass field so that it will be looking little bit beautiful. So this is our data set. You can understand 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, nearly 5 clusters will be formed, right? So what we'll be doing, we have to adjust the radius such that total number of distinct clusters will be formed should be equal to 5. Okay, now how we can do that? See, first output parameters, this one will be returning as cluster centers. This one is index, that is which data point is belonging to which cluster. And the third parameter is not required. Don't forget about that. So I have written not required. Okay. Now let's try to understand what will be happening. Now this index is same like we have used in k-means, right? Index position. So each time we'll be trying to adjust this particular radius, which has to be considered for mean shift clustering, such that total number of unique index or unique cluster should be 5. Okay, so let's start our radius with 5. This is, you can consider as default. So number of unique element is this time 78. Oh my god, quite huge. So see what I have discussed just now in the intuition theoretical part, that lesser radius, more number of clusters going to form, bigger radius, less number of clusters going to be formed. Now we are getting many clusters. Okay, so we need to reduce number of cluster, so we will increase the radius. Okay, so 5 to maybe 15 we can do, right? And here let's run. So number of unique index 8, our requirement is 5. Okay, so let me put 25. Let's check. This is how you have to do trial and error method. Gradually we are trying to decrease number of distinct clusters, and as a result we are eventually increasing the radius to be considered. Okay, so now we are getting 5. All right, we have achieved the result. So now we can comment this particular part, because this was just required for finding out the proper radius, and then here we can do scatter plot, obviously group wise scatter plot. Okay, pass the two input features, and this one is based on index. Okay, that is which data point is belonging to which cluster. Based on that index we are grouping and coloring. Okay, now this cluster center also we want to plot, but again here also cluster center you have to take transpose. Okay, this will give us in transpose format by default, so I am taking again transpose, because this is how function is written. That is the this is not the natural way of writing program, but anyway we don't have the inbuilt function, so we are going like this. So remember, function is same like k means, just whatever you are habituated, take transpose and give the data, that's all. Because here generally we consider columns as different features, rows at individual data point, but here reverse thing is present. Okay, so again here that's why cluster centers also we have to take transpose. And hold on, that is on same G scatter we are plotting. For I equal to 1 to 5 we are plotting one small circle in that center part. So as you know, the parametric equation of circle, x equal to a plus r cos theta, y equal to b plus r sin theta, same one we are implementing and filling using black color, that's all. So let's run this. Let's hope that proper clustering is will be achieved using this mean shift. Let's check. And yes, beautifully we have got the mean shift clustering. Okay, so this one is one group, this one is another group, this one is another group, this one is another group, and this one is another group. Okay, but here little bit problem is coming, but that is not an issue, because to achieve this result properly it might happen that you need to run this particular piece of code several times, and that is also not a big deal, because these things are very common in data science or machine learning related project. Because see, now this time we have got very accurate result. See, all these data points are coming under this particular region, all these data points are coming under this region, all these data points are coming under this cluster, and all these are this. Now customer segmentation is very simple. So this one is annual income, this one is pending score. So these are those pupils basically which is having less annual income, and as a result their pending score is less, which is quite obvious. These are those people which is having more annual income but less spending score. Okay, no problem, that means they are trying to save their money. These are belonging to moderate people, moderate annual income, moderate spending score. These are belonging to those people who spend their money without any proper management. Okay, that is less annual income but high spending score. And these are those people which is having high annual income as well as high spending score. So that means these customers are profitable for a company. Okay, because their income is high as well as their spending score is also high. That is, they are purchasing different products more. Okay, so customer our marketing team for a particular company should focus more on this particular customer sector. Anyway, so this is our MATLAB implementation. I hope you have understood. Remember the key points. main important parameter which you need to set properly is this particular radius. Then in this particular mean shift clustering, we cannot say directly how many clusters going to be formed. The number of clusters should be equal to number of dense region. Okay, and very important thing that if you keep this particular radius small, then many clusters going to be formed, and if you going to keep this particular radius big, then lesser number of clusters going to be formed. And if you are using this particular inbuilt function, this particular user defined function, that time what you have to do, you have to pass the data in the transpose way. That's how we are habituated. That is not followed in this particular use case, so we have to take transpose. And similarly, while plotting the using the cluster center also, we have to take eventually transpose. Okay, I'll providing the code in the description box or in the comment section. Go through the code and try to interpret the results. Once you will get hands-on in this particular domain, once you have some hands-on experience with this particular program, you will find this very simple and explored in different use cases, right? I hope you have enjoyed this particular session. This is all for this video. Thank you.